Word of Truth family, and welcome to Church Online. My name is Kyle, and it is so good to have you here with us today. It has never been easier to invite someone to church, so share the link, get your friends and family to watch. We are going to have an awesome service this morning. If this is your first time watching the service, I want to say welcome, and I hope you are blessed by the service. We have a digital connect card that we would love for you to fill out. The link will be posted in the chat below. We as a church believe that community is very important, and we have online life groups on Wednesday. If you would like to join a life group, message us on Facebook so we can help you grow, make friends, and stay in community. What's up, all the young people in the family? Once again, we are having the young adults hangout at 6 tonight. If you would like to join that, message us on Facebook and we will get you that link. Family, I would just like to clarify that we are having our 3 p.m. service on the 30th of August. That is next week, not this week. So if you would like to join that, we will be releasing more details on how you can book early. We can only take up to 50 people. So that is next week and not this week. If you come out this week, you're going to be out in the cold worshiping by yourself. So please, next week, not this week. We love to celebrate birthdays and anniversaries in our church, and I know this coming week we have Tinny on the 23rd, and Des and Ray are having their birthday on the 26th. We also have Agnes, you are having your birthday on the 28th. We also have Nyasha and Archie having their anniversary on the 26th. So happy birthday to those people and happy anniversary to you, Archie and Nyasha. If it is your birthday this coming week or your anniversary, comment down below, say, hey Carl, it's my birthday or my anniversary this coming week, and we would love to pray for you as well. Let's take a moment to pray for all of those having a birthday or an anniversary this coming week. Yes, Father. Father, I just pray for all of those having a birthday this coming week. Father, I pray that you would bless them abundantly, Father, and just bless them the rest of the days that they are on this earth, Father. Father, I pray for all of those having an anniversary, Father, that you would just show them your love, Father. Father, I thank you for the example that they set to the rest of the young people out there to show them how a marriage should look like, Father. Father, I just pray that you would bless them, keep them, and keep to show them your love during the rest of the time that they are together on this earth, Father. Amen. All right, family, that is my time up. But just before I go, I would like to remind you about the hangout after the service. The link will be posted in the chat below after the service. We would love to see you there and just to see how you are doing. Goodbye, family. Stay blessed and enjoy the rest of the service.
Hello, family, and welcome to Church Online. My name is Robin, and I'll be leading you in worship this morning along with this amazing worship team. Now, wherever you are this morning, I want to invite you to just turn your focus onto our amazing God as we just believe that He is going to touch us this morning. He's going to encounter us this morning as we just turn our focus to Him.
There is a river where goodness flows. There is a fountain that drowns sorrows. There is an ocean, and deeper than fear, the tide is rising, rising. There is a current stirring deep inside. It's overflowing from the heart of God. The flood of heaven crashing over us. The tide is rising. The weapon may be formed, but it won't prosper. When the darkness falls, it won't prevail. Because the God I serve knows only how to triumph. My God will never fail. Oh, my God will never fail. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord.
The enemy meant for evil.
Beautiful you are, God. There is no one like you in all the earth. We're here to worship you this morning. We're here because we love you and we long to have an encounter with you. And we recognize that apart from you, we are nothing. That you have no rival, that you have no equal. That there is nothing, that there is no one that comes close to who you are, to how good you are. And the love and the goodness that you just choose to pour out upon us again and again, no matter what we've done, no matter how far we've fallen. You are so good. You are so good to us, Lord God, even when we don't deserve it. And so this morning, God, we just want to lift your name high. We want to lift your name high, Jesus. Let all the honor, let all the glory be given to you this morning. In Jesus' name.
You were the Word at the beginning, one with God, the Lord Most High.
Jesus. You are holy, you are worthy.
Every knee will bow, every tongue confess your name. Every knee will bow, every tongue confess your name. Oh. Let's just sing that chorus one more time. What a powerful name it is. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is. Nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a powerful name.
Yes, Lord, your name is great. Your name is a strong tower that we run to. Lord, that we can run to and be saved. Darkness has to respond to your name. Darkness has to flee from your name. We need only call upon your name and be saved. We thank you for that, Lord. We thank you for your amazing grace. We thank you for the way you love us, for the way you pursue us, Lord. And we just give you all honor and glory this morning for how beautiful you are, for what a good and gracious Father you are to us, Lord. Take joy in what you see in us this morning. Pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Hey friends and family of Word of Truth Ministry, I am so excited that we can gather together online just to worship and magnify the King of Kings. His name is such a beautiful name, and his name is powerful. Great things are happening just at the mention of his name. And so it's a great joy for us to be gathered in this manner to lift up his name. David the psalmist said that I was glad when they said unto me, let us go to the house of the Lord. There is an excitement that comes into my spirit when I think of gathering with the saints, whether it is an in-person gathering or an online experience. The gathering remains a gathering. So I hope you are equally excited about gathering this morning. Okay, for the past 3 weeks, I've been talking about the courageous church, and I said to you that there was a strong sense in my spirit that God wants us to be strong and courageous for the next season. And many times when we speak of the next season, we don't know what the season looks like, and we just say it in faith, and we believe that God is preparing us for something. But as I was preparing for this new series that I want to introduce today, God started clarifying what the next season is going to look like. And one of the things that he made clear is that God wants to mobilize the church. He wants to bring the church together for a specific purpose, which is to go out. And I want you to understand that the next season of this church, which is no longer the next season, it is the now season. The season that we have entered into is a season of action. It is a season of going. It is a season of doing great things in the name of Jesus Christ. And so we cannot afford to be cowards and to be timid, to hide behind things and make all sorts of excuses. We need to be bold. We need to be courageous. We need to step up and begin to make a difference in our community. So I'm really excited about this season, because in this season, God is calling us to come together for this one purpose, to go out. And actually, this has always been God's intention for the church. When you really look at that word ecclesia, from which we get the word church, the idea behind the gathering, the assembly, the idea behind the coming together of the saints is so much, is so that we could be deployed into the mission field. God did not call us to gather just so that we can have a good time together and sing kumbaya. No, God called us to come together so that we may receive our marching orders and then we will go out and make a difference. If we are going to be a courageous church, we need to understand the purpose of the church. And so as we enter into this new season, God started talking to me about the vision that he gave us, which was our theme for this year, still is the theme of this year. There is a more excellent way. And he said to me, Justin, there is a more excellent way of doing church. You've been doing church right. You've been enjoying church. Things have been great. You've had amazing programs, but there is a more excellent way. Church is more than just a place where we come and worship. Church is more than just the programs that we run, the fellowship that we enjoy. I know many people are excited about the idea of coming out for this in-person gathering, but God is actually saying, what are you excited about? Is it the gathering or it's what the gathering is going to produce? Because if we just gather for the sake of gathering, we are gathering in vain. The purpose of the gathering was never meant to be an end in itself. The gathering is simply a means to an end. The end result of every church gathering should be going out. And so if we gather and we fail to go out, we are gathering in vain. If we gather and we fail to march according to the mission that God has given us, our gathering is not necessarily unto the Lord. It is anything but not unto the Lord. So when we gather in the name of Jesus Christ, there has to be this mobilization that takes place in the spirit, and then there must be a deployment, a release for us to go out and make a difference. God wants the church to advance his kingdom forcefully in this season, and we cannot afford to be timid about this. We can't apologize about our mission. So we need to be strong, and we need to be very courageous. For too long, we have limited the church to just a place of fellowship, a place of worship, a place where we enjoy good programs and we are taught and we are fed. And God is saying that is not the church. The church is a place where we assemble. When I'm talking about this gathering, the gathering is a place of assembling so that we can be deployed. And this is what God is going to be doing through Word of Truth Ministry in this season, releasing each and every one of us into the mission field. God wants you to be equipped for the work of the ministry. Now, listen to me. The church is a place where you are equipped so that you can do some work for the kingdom of God. If you are not working for the kingdom of God, you are not part of this church. You are not part of the ecclesia. You are not part of this gathering, the called out ones who are called in order to be sent. There has to be a clear assignment. Everyone in Word of Truth Ministry in this season must have a clear assignment. You must know exactly what God is calling you to do in this season. Because if you are a Christian without an assignment, you are not part of the ecclesia. You are not part of the chosen. Listen to me. The Bible says many are called, but a few are chosen. So when we look at this idea of the ecclesia, it was when you needed an army to gather, you would send a call, release a call that or sound the trumpet that people would gather. Everyone who heard the sound of the trumpet would gather. And as they gather, you would then choose from the gathering people that you would release into the battlefield. And so God is saying many are called. Right now we are saying there is a service coming, church is open, and everybody is excited about coming. But when you gather, there is going to be a process of choosing. And I want you, Word of Truth Ministry, not just to gather for the sake of gathering. I want us every time when we gather to have a desire to be the chosen ones, that God will choose me, that whatever mission God has for us, God let it be me. You see, in wartime, you will be chosen according to your skills and your expertise, your experience in fighting. But when it comes to the kingdom of God, what separates the called or the chosen from the called is simply a willingness to avail yourself. If you say, yes, Lord, here I am, God will choose you. Everyone who avails themselves for service is going to be chosen in this season. And like we said of Gideon, whether you've got a broken background, whether your life is in a mess, as long as you're willing to say yes, God is going to transform you in this season and is going to do great exploits through you. So this season is going to be a radical season. God is changing the way we do church. Everything about church has to shift in this new season. And so God is saying, change the way you do church. Change the way you gather so that people may gather with this one goal in mind, to be released and to go out. So I think the problem with the church is that we have developed a culture of gathering, and we have overemphasized this culture of gathering at the expense of the purpose of the church, which is the going. God called us to gather so that we may go. The first century church had to be reminded not to neglect the gathering together of the saints, because their culture was a culture of going to advance the kingdom. Everyone was thinking of what is my next mission? What else can I do for the kingdom of God? That the apostles had to write to them and say, hey guys, don't neglect the gathering. While you are advancing the kingdom, remember gathering is important. But I have a feeling that if the apostles were to write to the church today, they would say to the most of the body of Christ, hey guys, you've built an awesome culture of gathering, but don't neglect the going, because Jesus says, go into the world and make disciples. So it's the going that we need to activate or reactivate in the church today. And you and I are being called to gather so that we can be released or commissioned to go. So I'm excited because our church is going to become a going church. When you look at the first century church, it was a church on the move. The book of Acts is just a collection of stories of what the church was doing every single day. It was an action-packed church. And we can no longer sit back and be bored at home and say there's nothing we can do for the kingdom. We need to be active. We need to be daily advancing the kingdom of God. God is saying, as we are being called out of our lockdown season, as we have been called out back into this in-person gathering, He is saying, I want you to come with the idea of receiving your assignment so that you can go back. Not coming with the idea of like, wow, I just missed the gathering of the saints. I missed the fellowship. And we come and we sing and we rejoice and we forget the mission. God is saying, the reason why I'm calling you together is to give you your mind in orders so that you can go back. The focus of the church should not be a gathering. So we should not place or overemphasize the Sunday gathering. In fact, God is saying, He's going to shift our focus from the Sunday gathering to an everyday experience. That when we gather on Sunday, we're saying, God, give us the marching orders for Monday, for Tuesday, for Wednesday, for Thursday, for Friday, for Saturday. Give us daily marching orders that when we come together, we may know exactly what we need to do in the course of the week. And so our church has to move from being a Sunday gathering to an everyday experience. And for this to happen, it requires you and I to be strong, to be courageous, and to begin to move with what God is saying. So God is saying there is a more excellent way of doing church. I remember in the beginning of the year, we spoke about the five remarkables, the areas that we need to grow or excel in order to be this remarkable church. And I want to start talking in this new series about the remarkable church. What makes a church remarkable? What makes us a church that people will begin to notice that there's something about these people that is different? Remember, the whole idea of being a Christian is a recognition from the community that these men have been with the Christ. And so we want to be that kind of church that stands out. Yes, there are many churches in the world. There are many churches online right now. You can move from one church to another. But God wants us to be a remarkable church, a church that stands out. And one of the ways in which we are going to stand out is to rediscover the purpose of the church. You and I have to ask ourselves, what is the purpose of the church? And so today I want to take you on a journey, and I want you to follow with me or trek with me as we follow Jesus to the point that He made this announcement that He's about to build His church and the gates of Hades or the gates of hell will not prevail against it. So I'm going to read from Matthew chapter number 16 and verse 13. The Bible says, when Jesus came into the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, saying, who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? So they said, some say John the Baptist, some Elijah, others Jeremiah, or one of the other prophets. And he said to them, but who do you say I am? Simon Peter answered and said, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Jesus answered and said to him, blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I say to you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades shall not prevail against it. On this rock I will build my ecclesia. Ecclesia is that Greek word that is used for church. It carries the idea of the assembly. It carries the idea of those who are called out in order to be sent out. You need to complete the picture, because many times when we talk about the gathering or the ecclesia as an assembly, we make the gathering the end result of the call. The call was not just specifically to gather. It was, we gather with a mission, with a mind that we are going to be sent out. That's the idea of an ecclesia. So he says, I will build my ecclesia, and the gates of Hades or hell will not prevail against it. Now, I want us to look at this region called Caesarea Philippi, in which Jesus chose to make the announcement. You must understand that Jesus is coming from Galilee. He was ministering in Galilee, but he travels almost 40 kilometers up north to a place called Caesarea Philippi so that he may teach his disciples about the church. Now, I want you to understand something about Jesus. Jesus is a master at setting the stage for great teachable moments. For example, when he wanted to teach the children of Israel or his followers that he was the bread of life, he first set the stage by feeding people miraculously with 5 loaves and 2 fish. And while they were marveling at this miracle, he then makes the announcement that I am the bread of life. When he wanted to reveal to the world that he was the resurrection, he first went to a place where Lazarus was buried, and he rose Lazarus from the dead. And then when everybody was like, wow, he makes the announcement, I am the resurrection and the life. So with this in mind, Jesus is purposefully leading his disciples to a place called Caesarea Philippi, because he wants to teach them an important lesson about the church. So 40 kilometers up north, he takes his disciples with him, and he comes to the region of Caesarea Philippi. And the Bible says, when he came into this region, he asked them, who do men say I am? So this region must be very, very important. And when you start studying this region, you understand why Jesus made the announcement in Caesarea Philippi and not in Capernaum and not in Galilee and not anywhere else that he has been. He could have made the announcement in Tyre or in Sidon, but he withheld that revelation until he came into a region called Caesarea Philippi. Now, what you need to understand about this city is that this was a Greco-Roman Roman city, where the Greeks and the ancient Romans had taken the city and turned it into the center of worship. When I say the center of worship, it was the center of pagan worship. It was the center of business and trade. It was actually the capital of the Roman province in Judea. This place is a place of governance. This is a place of, it's a political city. It is a place of authority. It's a very significant region. Caesarea Philippi was the capital of the Roman province in Judea, which means that all these judicial laws were passed in this place. So when he came into the city, he then now uses the context and the background of what was going on to lay or to set the stage for the announcement that he was about to make. Now, what you need to understand about this city is, even though it was a strong political city, it was also a very strong demonic place. It was a very strong demonic city. All sorts of demonic activities were taking place in Caesarea Philippi. There were about five major demonic strongholds that were well known and established in the city. In the Old Testament times, this is the region where King Jeroboam had built a high place that angered God, because at this high place they worshipped Baal. So in the Old Testament, the worship of Baal happened within this region. This is where they were worshiping Baal in the Old Testament. Actually, they say in Deuteronomy chapter number 2 and 3, the idea of the giants that fell, the angels that fell from the heavens who were giants, the Nephilims, that there's an idea that within this northern region, within this whole area, this is a place where they will have sexual relations with the daughters of men. So there is a whole lot of demonic activity that is associated with this place. And when we come into the New Testament, we discover that the Greeks were worshiping the Pan god. This god Pan, who is the god of fertility, I think it was being worshipped in this place. And all sorts of people would come and they would offer sacrifices at this place in Caesarea Philippi. And they actually say there's a cave. I'm sure we're going to put it up on the screen for you. There's a cave that was there that they believe that people would literally bring their children and they would throw them into this cave as sacrifices, because they believe that pleased their Pan god. The same region, the same area is where they established, or where I think it was Philip the Tetrarch, he built a temple for Zeus in honor of the Emperor Augustus. And so there's a whole lot of demonic activity from worship of men. When they build this temple in honor of Augustus, there's worship of men. The pride of men is ruling in this area. When we speak of the fertility gods and how they would sacrifice their kids, we're speaking of abortion. When we speak of Baal worship, that's a whole sexual promiscuity, pornography, all those kind of stuff. The demonic stuff was happening here. No God-fearing person wanted to be in Caesarea Philippi. Everybody who knew what was going on in Caesarea Philippi did not want to be in this region. And yet Jesus deliberately leads his disciples, his followers, the church. He leads them to this place. And when he came into this region, he asks them, "Who do men say I am?" Now, in this context, everyone around them was worshiping foreign gods. Everyone around them was worshiping false gods. And in this context, Jesus asks, "Who do men say I am?" So if they looked around, they would have seen some people worshiping Zeus, some people worshiping Pan, some people worshiping men, some people worshiping Baal. They would have seen all sorts of demonic activity around them. And in that environment, it was impossible for somebody to get the revelation that Jesus Christ was the Messiah, that Jesus was the Son of the only true living God. And yet in the spirit, God revealed it to Peter. And even though his surrounding told him that this is a demonic realm, this is a demonic region, that the prince of this world is ruling over this region, the god of this world is ruling over this region, he got the revelation that this one is the true God. This one is the Christ, the anointed one, the solution to all the problems, the God that all these false, all these religious people are looking for. This is him. And so Peter said, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And now when Peter said that, I've taught this extensively before, but I felt to teach you this one revelation that God just gave me the other day as I was preparing for this message, is that, yes, it was upon the revelation that he was the Christ that the church was going to be established. We cannot be a church if we don't know who Jesus Christ is. Because to be a church is to respond to the one who has called us. And so we need to understand the one who called us, who is Jesus Christ, which is great. And I've taught this extensively in the past, that the revelation of Jesus Christ is the foundation upon which the church is built. But this is what the Lord showed me this time around. When he said, I will build my church upon this rock, when Jesus led the children of Israel, rather when Jesus led his disciples to Caesarea Philippi. Caesarea Philippi is a region of rocky ground. It's just all sorts of rocky ground. So when he led them into this region, you are standing at a place where all this demonic activity was built, where there was this rock upon which all these demonic altars have been established. And Jesus was saying to his disciples, upon this rock, upon this same ground where the demonic activity is ruling, where there's all sorts of demonic activity, upon this I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not prevail against it. Now, if you were alive in Jesus' time, when he said the gates of Hades, you would have understood exactly what he was talking about. The gates of hell were right there in Caesarea Philippi. They all believed that in Caesarea Philippi, where all these altars were established, this entrance to this cave, they called that entrance the gate to the underworld. They called it the gate of hell. And you can study this in ancient history, that there is actually people that believed that if you entered into that cave, you will have access to the underworld. It's the gates of hell. And whether that was true or not, that's what people believed. And so no Christian or no God-fearing person would have wanted to come and start a church in Caesarea Philippi, because this is where the gates of hell were established. This is the entrance to the underworld. And yet Jesus leads his disciples. Can you imagine Jesus coming with 12 of his disciples? And he's coming to a place and he says, now guys, who do men say I am? And they're like, oh yeah, you are the Christ. And he says, all right, now I'm about to make an announcement. Today, because of the revelation you have gained that I am the Christ, upon this rock, upon this ground, upon this very ground that we are standing, where all this activity is happening, I am going to establish the church. I am going to sound the trumpet, and I'm going to call the assembly to come right here to confront all these demonic things. The church was never called to be in hiding. The church was never called out to retreat and to hide behind closed doors. No. Jesus wanted it to be clear that the church is being called to confront the gates of hell. The church was established with this one goal, to be a force that would attack the gates of hell. Now, I want you to understand this in the spirit. The gates of hell, the gates represent defense structure. The gates were a symbol of defense. When the gates were open, or when the city had no walls or no gates, it was exposed. But when a city was behind closed gates, they felt safe. And so Jesus leads the church to come face to face with the gates of hell, right where the demonic activity is rife, right where everyone is worshiping foreign gods. He leads the church to that point, and he said, I will establish you to confront these gates. I want you to understand that the church was never called to retreat. The church was called to advance, to attack the gates of hell. We are not the ones that are hiding behind gates. We are the ones that are knocking and shaking the gates of the enemy. And in the past, I have failed to see this. I've always thought that, hey, hell is trying to attack the church. No, the church is attacking the kingdom of hell. It's not the devil attacking you. If the devil is attacking you, you have failed to understand your mission as the church. We've got too many Christians that are always saying, oh, the devil is attacking me. Oh, I can't do anything because the devil is attacking me. What are you doing behind closed gates and waiting for the devil to attack you? You need to take the fight to the gates of hell. You need to take the fights to the ruling authorities. You need to take the fight to the place of governance and authority. We need to take the fight to where the demonic activity is. And God is saying, for this to happen, we need a courageous church. A church that is not going to hide, but a church that is going to march right into the enemy's camp and take back what the enemy has stolen from you. I don't know what the devil has stolen from you. I don't know what the enemy has been stealing these past 5 or 6 months. I don't know for how long has the devil been messing with you. But I heard the Lord say, as we enter into this season, the days of staying behind closed doors are over. The days of hiding behind your closed high walls and gates are over. You need to begin to respond to the call of God and begin to march towards the enemy's camp. You need to find where the demonic activity is in Port Alfred, and you need to go and confront those demonic forces and authorities, and you need to establish the church of Jesus Christ. I heard the Lord say that the church, the time has come for the church to establish its authority on the earth. We can no longer just receive instruction from the ruling authorities. We need to now say to the ruling authorities, whatever we bind on earth will be bound in heaven. Whatever we loose on earth will be loosed on heaven. We have to have a say on what is approved in our communities and in our societies. And God is saying, word of truth, you need to be strong. You need to be courageous. You cannot be afraid of the enemy. You cannot be afraid of attacks. You cannot be afraid of authorities. You need to begin to stand up and take your rightful place so that we can make a difference in our community. And this requires courage. God never established a church to hide. The church was called out to march into the enemy's territory. And I'm saying to you, word of truth, in this season, I will be leading you into the enemy's territory. I will be leading you in the places where you're like, I'm not sure we should be doing this. And I'm saying God is calling us to take the kingdom, to advance his kingdom and gain ground for our king. This is what God is calling us to do. And it requires us to be strong, and it requires us to be courageous. So when we look at the purpose of the church, we are called to engage with the ruling authorities. Not to hide behind closed doors and let other people speak on our behalf. We need to be a voice that will be heard in Caesarea Philippi. So which one is your Caesarea Philippi? We need to be a voice that is dealing with our own Caesarea Philippi, the places of authority. And I heard the Lord say in Port Alfred, the church has to be consulted when things happen in our town. When we take our rightful place, what we bind on earth will be bound in the heavens, and what we loose will be loosed in the heavens. Now, I wanna close with this thought. You have been called not to separate yourself. You must understand that in the Jewish culture, they grew up being told you need to set yourself apart. So most of the disciples that had a Jewish background were afraid of mingling with the pagan worshippers. They would have never dreamt of going to Caesarea Philippi to start a church. They would have never marched into the Red District, into the areas, the hot spots, the crime-infested areas. They would have kind of like, now we're not supposed to be going there. But Jesus leads them there. And in the midst of all this demonic activity, I was sharing with my wife, my crazy preacher's mind was going wild. And I was saying, imagine Jesus trying to teach about the church and there's some woman who's going to the cave with a baby, ready to just sacrifice that child to Pan. Or on the other side, people that were engaging in Baal worship, bestiality, and all those kind of things were taking place around him. But Jesus was not focusing on what the enemy was doing. He simply made an announcement. I am here to build the church and the gates of Hades. And when he said the gates of Hades, he was looking at literally the gates of Hades in their context. And he said, what you are seeing right now does not stand a chance against the church. What you are seeing in the world right now does not stand a chance against the church. Jesus was actually picking a fight with the devil and said, I am here to challenge you. Bring your best demonic activity against my church. And I can imagine if he only had 12 or maybe the 72 disciples, I don't know how many people he had. If he only had the 12, imagine just 12 men standing here and saying, we are ready to take these thousands of people who are worshiping false gods. That's a courageous church. That's a remarkable church. That's a church that everybody will notice. It's not a church that is timid or hiding. The Bible goes on to say, listen to this, in verse 20. Then he commanded his disciples that they should not tell anyone that he was Jesus the Christ. From that time, from that moment, Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things from the elders and the chief priests and the scribes and be killed and be raised the third day. Then Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him, saying, far be it from you, Lord, it shall not happen to you. You see, Peter, who had the revelation of who Christ was, did not have the revelation of what the church is going to look like. He's now standing in the way of what God wants to do with the church. You see, there are many people that have been standing in the way of what God wants to do in the church. He began to show them the things that they need to suffer. Being a Christian, being a follower of Jesus Christ requires you to go through some pain, go through some suffering, go through some trials, go through some hardships. And he began to show them those things. And Peter said, no. It's not worthy. You're not supposed to go through these things. And Jesus says, get behind me, Satan. When the church becomes too comfortable that it does not have the courage to go out and suffer for Jesus, to go out and make a difference, it has allowed the devil to rule over it. So Jesus said, I'm not going to allow it. Get behind me. Stop looking at what the devil is doing and focus on what the Christ is doing. Then he reveals the level of commitment that he expected from them. After he says, get behind me, Satan. He says in verse 24, then Jesus said to his disciples, if anyone desires to come after me, let him deny himself. Take up his cross and follow me. This is the secret. If we are going to be the remarkable church that God wants us to be, Word of Truth, we need to pick up our cross, deny ourselves, and follow Jesus. And let me tell you where Jesus is taking us. Not into a church building. Jesus is not taking us into a private room somewhere so that we can just drink coffee and have cool conversations. Jesus is saying, follow me to right to the gates of Hades and let us confront the ruling authorities, the evil authorities. Remember, we fight not against flesh and blood, but we're fighting against the powers and the principalities that are ruling in our regions. So he's saying, I want you to understand that I called you so that you can confront the ruling spirits that are over your region. Word of Truth Ministry, we need to confront the ruling spirits that are over our region. And to do this, we need to be strong, we need to be courageous, we need to be dead to self. And we're going to be doing this over the next couple of weeks, just unpacking the vision of what the courageous church, or the remarkable church rather, is going to look like. And I want to encourage you. This is going to be the most amazing series we have done in a very long time. This is going to be a practical series. It's going to be in-your-face kind of teaching. And I know that when you get the picture of what the church is supposed to do, your life will radically change. You'll no longer be content coming to church just to drink a cup of coffee and have fellowship. You'll no longer be content to just come to church and sing a couple of songs and go back home and say, I was in church. There is another dimension to church that is going to come out in this season. And Word of Truth Ministry, we need to be ready because the season has thus come. Amen. I hope this message has stirred something in your spirit. I have just kind of shared some fragmented thoughts on where we are going, but we're going to be putting a series together just around this remarkable church, understanding the mission and the purpose of the church so that we can be ready for action. God is mobilizing us for the work that he has for us in this season. Amen. God bless you. Thank you for allowing me into your home and giving me this opportunity to minister to you. We're going to go into our Zoom hangout. Hope to see you there, where we're going to just have some time to fellowship and catch up with one another. God bless you. Have a powerful week. Amen.